Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. In the last installment of the Jewish History Lab, we looked at the terrible pogroms of the Civil War period. As we discussed there, ultimately the Soviet forces, the Red Army, were able to seize control of those areas where Jews primarily lived in the former Pale of Settlement. And once they were able to establish Soviet rule over the entire region, they began to impose the very different philosophy and political system that was associated with early communism. And that's the period that I'd like to look at today. I'd like to look at the period from the end of the Civil War up until really the last couple of years of the Civil War, right up until World War II, because it was a tremendously expansive time in some ways and restrictive in other ways. Let us begin with a discussion of the Yevsektsiya. The Soviets are very, very fond of acronyms. It's an abbreviation of the term Yevreisky Sektsiya, the Jewish section of the Communist Party. And this was a segment of the Communist Party that was formed under this individual, Simon Diemenstein, a communist who actually was previously a Chabad rabbi, who was thoroughly defrocked, as it were, and completely removed from his religious moorings. That's the kind of thing that frequently happened with those Jews who associated themselves with communism in this early period. Diemenstein was assigned the task of propagandizing this largely very traditional population, that traditional specifically when you get outside of the large cities where there is much less secularism, much more old traditional observance in the shtetlach, the small villages that dotted the now Soviet countryside, and bringing them into this brand new, radically atheistic, totally different economic system, divorcing them from their Jewish roots, while at the same time successfully bringing them forward into this new Soviet era. Definitely a great challenge, and they evolved some really interesting strategies to try and do it. In the general political environment in the first few years was especially dire. The period 1918 to 1920 is generally called the era of war communism. And during this period of war communism, when the Civil War was still being prosecuted and there were still, numerous forces, including in particular the Ukrainian Directory and Makhno and the anarchists and the White Russian forces, that is the Russians who wanted to bring back some form of the monarchy or at least get rid of the communists and establish some kind of more capitalist society in its place. The communists were still fighting this war in real time, and war communism as a kind of like a temporary period characterized their attempts to rapidly bring the entire population into the very doctrinaire and policies of communism as a whole, including things like confiscation of land and collectivization of farming, bringing individual farmers together into a larger collective. This would ultimately slow down and then speed up dramatically later, about a decade later under communism. The outlawing of all kinds of forms of commerce and, shutting down capitalist enterprises, being very, very aggressively attacking any kind of religious behavior and so on. And this went on for about 2 years. Confiscations of Torah scrolls from synagogues, real persecution, but it was across the board, not just Jews, obviously. Any religious individual in this newly atheistic society felt definitely very out of place. This was followed as the war began to calm down and as the anti-Soviet forces were slowly quelled, and it was replaced by something called NEP, which was another acronym, this time in English, for the New Economic Program. This was what was generally conceded as kind of like a one step backward in order to later take two steps forward. And, the new regime could not maintain this phenomenal energy of demanding, confiscating, ordering people around for such a long period of time, especially exhausted after these years of war, which you'll recall immediately followed after World War I, right? World War I just ended in November 1918. The new economic policy was kind of like just relaxing some of these controls a little bit and allowing the economy to kind of develop again slightly, ultimately NEP would be shut down, but for a brief period of time till about 1924, that began to, you know, sort of take the knee off the neck of the larger population, and the new Soviet Union began to recover. In terms of the leadership, let's just recall that there is a triumvirate that are especially important at this time. There are other figures that are also very important, like Bukharin, but if we focus on the triumvirate, there is, of course, Lenin, who is the first leader of the Soviet Union. He has a stroke in 1922, if I remember correctly, that renders him incapacitated. And he lives for a couple more years, but during that time, which was during the period of NEP, there was a big question as to who was going to be his successor. There are some who favored Trotsky, the Jewish leader of the Red Army, who had shown tremendous skill at expanding the control of the Soviet Union. But others favored Stalin, who was a much more brutal individual, coming from Georgia. He was an expert on the nationalities question, which was sort of communist speak for the non-Russians who lived within the Soviet Union. Of course, there's a lot of non-Russians living in the Soviet Union. And he ultimately would end up very cleverly maneuvering himself around Trotsky, around Bukharin after Lenin's death, and ultimately he would become the leader. And the 30s were dominated by Stalin right up until his death in the early 1950s. So back to where we are. Diemenstein was placed in charge of the Jewish section of the Communist Party, and this was initially during the period of war communism, but during the period of NEP, he saw that he had quite a bit more freedom to explore the methodology of bringing the Jewish population into communism. Let us recall that although there was a disproportionate number of Jews in the Communist Party for their population, and this is especially true as you move up towards the leadership of the Soviet Union, where there was like sometimes a third of governing bodies were dominated by Jews. There used to be a joke in Yiddish that there was an acronym VITSIK, which referred to the all Russian Central Committee, Всероссийский Центральный Комитет, and in Yiddish they would say that it wasn't a Russian acronym, it was a Yiddish acronym for Vutzen Eden Kommandieren, where 10 Jews are in charge. That was not a truism. You never had a majority of Jews anywhere in any institution of the Soviet Union, but there were very important influential Jews, and they were out of proportion to their size of the population. That said, the proportion of Jews who became communists was tiny. There was the vast majority of Jews were hostile to communism, seeing it as a threat to their traditional way of life, especially those who were religiously oriented, who recognized the threat of the anti-clerical nature of the Soviet Union. So it's a great complex of issues involved here. The thing that made the Soviet Union very popular in the Civil War period, as we discussed in the previous lecture, was the fact that Trotsky's Red Army forces were far less likely to commit pogroms than the other forces that were ravaging the countryside. That engendered an enthusiastic support for the Red Army that was translated initially in the early 1920s to support for the Soviet Union. But as we shall see, it rapidly declined. The policy that Diemenstein seized upon, which was generally issued during the more liberal period of the 1920s for all of the non-Russian nationalities, was a policy that went by the name Korenizatsiya. This is kind of a strange word. It's difficult to translate into English. The word Koren can mean like a root. And so it can be translated as rootification, like roots as in a tree. Or I've seen it translated as indigenization, which kind of like was a way of thinking about the general society and identifying those elements of the indigenous culture which were compatible with communism and actively encouraging those factors. The slogan of the era was nationalist in form, but socialist in content, meaning they could wear their national costumes, they could eat their national foods, they could speak their national language, as long as none of the things that they did or said challenged the economic and political ideology of communism, right? Nationalist in form, okay, but socialist in content. As soon as they got into things like, you know, a level of ethnocentrism, that would be definitely not socialist in content. If they wanted to defend their national religion, definitely not socialist in content. So this idea of Koronizatsiya was kind of reaching into the roots with this kind of like, you know, theory operating that communism was the true form of human organization. And if you dug below the accreted layers of corruption that came in from bourgeois democracy, you would find that people are naturally communist and they just spoke different language, kind of like, you know, happily wearing embroidered dresses or dancing the hora, whether they eat kreplach or whether they ate, I don't know, pirohe, and whatever it would be, they would still be naturally communist if only you could get past all those other things. So that's the policy of Koronizatsiya. And what Diemenstein did was he took that material and he said, let us go to the Jewish people with the authentic element of their cultures and talk to them about communism. Now, there were a few challenges, one of which, really huge, was this idea of atheism, right? Because Jews are overwhelmingly united by their religion. Even when they're rebelling against their religion, they still regard themselves as some kind of, you know, loose tribal familial affiliation that is rooted in a long religious tradition. And this was anathema to the Soviet cause. So one of the things that the Soviet Union stood up in the 1920s was an institution called the League of Militant Atheists. Sounds almost funny, actually. And this was targeting all religions, of course, not just Judaism. They published this magazine here. This is called Bezhbozhnik, which means literally godless. And in this particular anti-Christian image, they're showing obviously, Jesus, who was getting all of the various followers drunk to the point of vomiting and really trying to illustrate Marx's idea of, you know, religion being an opiate of the masses, that religion keeps you drunk, religion keeps you high and unable to appreciate your true class enemies and things like that. So there was a Yiddish version of Bezhbozhnik, and there were tremendous amounts of effort placed in trying to like do things, crazy things, like rewrite the Haggadah, rewrite the Passover liturgy. They wrote a red Haggadah that celebrated, you know, Stalin and Marx instead of Moses, that, you know, Pharaoh was portrayed as the Tsar and all kinds of things like this. And they used the Yiddish language in particular to try and get this material across. Yiddish was considered the true folk language of the Soviet Jewish people, even though it's essentially medieval German written in Hebrew characters. But that was the native tongue of like 97-98% of the Jewish people at the end of the 19th century living in the region of the Russian Empire. And so they said, we'll speak to them and we'll write to them in their Yiddish language. And so there was a flourishing of attention lavished on anything in Yiddish which would be considered compatible with Soviet culture. A lot of money was spent on Yiddish writers. There was a renaissance of Yiddish poetry. You actually have Yiddish writers leaving America to go back to Russia because they saw this as a tremendous, you know, culture effervescence. And in fact, in the 1920s, it looked very encouraging that Yiddish would have a tremendous heyday. Now, it was not a normal Yiddish, I have to say, because, you know, the more they poked around with it, the more they messed it up. Yiddish is, as I mentioned, written in Hebrew characters, and it is heavily populated by Hebraic terms, Aramaic terms as well. And Hebrew was considered outside of the pale because that was too closely associated with religion. But, and also in modern Hebrew, it was too closely associated with Zionism, also not compatible with Soviet thought. So, you know, what do you do when you have common Hebrew words in the Yiddish language? Like, for example, chaver, which is translated into Russian as tovarich, as in English, comrade. How do you, you know, speak Yiddish without the word comrade in the Soviet Union? So what they would do is say, okay, you can keep the word chaver, but you have to write it out phonetically, spell it phonetically, rather than spelling it with the traditional Hebrew spelling. So for those of you who are familiar with the letters, the word for chaver in Hebrew and in Yiddish is chet veit resh, three letters. But in Yiddish, in the Soviet period, it will be written chaf aleph vav vav ayin resh, which is 3 6 letters. And if you didn't know what you're looking at, you'll be totally confused when you saw it. So many words were written like this. And by the way, once again, the Soviets attacked all of the nationalities in this form. The Ukrainians, for example, had a letter G, G, which is distinct from the Russian letter G. And so they actually made the Ukrainian letter G illegal. If you used the Ukrainian letter G rather than the letter that looked like the letter H and pronounced it like a Russian letter H, you could be sent to Siberia. Here's something I find really ironic and amusing. This is the Russian translation of the Hebrew prayer book, the Siddur, which of course would have been totally off limits to these very atheistic Russians. And you can see in Cyrillic letters, it has the word, the large word Siddur, right, the prayer book. And then underneath you see it has the words Tehillat Hashem, which means the Psalms of God or the Songs of God. And the word Hashem, of course, is pronounced with the letter H, but there is no letter H in the Russian alphabet. So in order to indicate that it should be pronounced as an H, they took the letter G, you can see in the second word there, and they added a small accent mark on the top to let you know that you should pronounce this as an H. So it's really very ironic, because one of the things that the Yevsektsiya did was they looked at 5 letters of the Hebrew alphabet, the so-called manatspach, that are written differently at the end of a word than if they were written at the beginning of the word, and they said those letters are illegal. You can't use those 5 letters. They're essentially like capital letters, because it's too hard for people to learn. It's not proletarian. We should have a simple language, a simple alphabet. So they tried to take away these 5 letters from the Yiddish alphabet, like they tried to take away the G from the Ukrainian alphabet. And so in return, we forced a new letter on them, right? You can see the word Hashem, that H is actually an imposition into the Russian alphabet in order to accommodate a Hebrew sound. Ironic. Okay, so back to where we are. So during the 1920s, explosion of Yiddish activity under the Yevsektsiya, and one last detail, this actually occurred a little bit afterwards, but it's still quite fascinating. At one point, the Soviet Union even experimented with creating a kind of alternative Israel. They created a homeland, a Jewish autonomous oblast called Birobidzhan, which was way out in the border with China. It was 4,000 miles away from where Jews were actually living. And the idea was, we're going to make a homeland for Jews. You don't have to think about Israel. You don't have to be constantly pressuring us to go to Israel. You have your own homeland in Birobidzhan. Now, it's kind of an interesting thing. Yiddish was made an official language of Birobidzhan and stuff like that. But they had very few Jews actually live there, primarily because Stalin blocked a lot of the migration there exactly when the Jews could have used it during World War II. At any rate, to sum up, the 1920s, period of incredible creativity, although very atheistic, but a huge surge of popularity of Yiddish language culture in particular. This came crashing to a halt in the 1930s under this man, Joseph Stalin. Stalin was able, by the end of the 1920s, to firmly consolidate his control over the entire region, and he had very little patience for all of these kind of national inform and socialist and content experiments. He shut down the Yevsektsiya. Incidentally, another organization that he also shut down was the Women's Section of the Communist Party that had exactly the same lifespan as the Jewish section. And Stalin said, we have to focus ourselves on industrialization. He instituted a number of 5-year plans which were designed to rapidly propel the Soviet Union into modernity by building massive things like huge hydroelectric dams at Dnipropetrovsk and other places like that. But he created this kind of environment in which people were desperately pressured to report results. And what ended up happening was that people were faking the results rather than, you know, tell the truth to power and say, hey, we can't possibly produce this much pig iron over this amount of time, or we can't possibly harvest that much grain in this much time. One of the most terrifying and awful results of the five-year plans was the Holodomor, this massive terror famine that in particular affected the Ukrainian regions. In 1932-33, a huge number of people, it's very difficult to get a good sense of exactly how many. Reasonable estimates are around 5 or 6 million, though, a huge number of people, and there are larger estimates as well. This colossally awful artificial famine, which killed millions of people, was largely a result of the disastrous economic planning of Stalin and his henchmen. It was actually a terrifically horrible event. And in context with the Holodomor and several other related factors, the purges began in the Soviet Union, especially towards the end of the 1930s. As people began to see that the, you know, glorious reports of Soviet productivity were not evident in reality, rather than say, wait a second, maybe people are exaggerating their findings about, you know, how much they're able to produce. Instead, they blamed non-existent saboteurs, that there were wreckers, there were people who were somehow, you know, deciding to stand in the way of progress for the Soviet Union. And these people were identified, tortured, and forced to divulge the names of other saboteurs. This created this ecosystem of purges that was not at all unlike the Spanish Inquisition, in which heresy was hunted out everywhere. People were taken and tortured and asked to betray the names of other heretics and so on. And even if a person wasn't a heretic or didn't even know any heretics, they were nevertheless under the pain of torture and give up all kinds of names. This initiated a horrific cycle of arrest, torture, confession, arrest, torture, confession that resulted in millions of people, again, the scale is phenomenal, being exiled to the Gulag out in Siberia or even executed. And this really consumed the Soviet Union in the later 1930s. And at this point, you know, the Jewish enthusiasm for the Soviet Union collapsed dramatically. Prominent Jews were purged early on in this period of Stalinist cleansing of the party and then later of society. And Jews, with a few significant exceptions, like Kaganovich, who was involved in Ukraine during the years of the Holodomor, with the exception of a few characters, much of the Soviet leadership was purged of its Jewish membership. And the kind of like popularity that the Red Army enjoyed in 1919 was nowhere to be seen, as people around the world began to realize what Stalin really stood for. So by the time you get to the late 1930s, what was once a more significant participation of some Jews in the Communist Party was reduced to a tiny, tiny remnant. And this is where we're going to have to pick up the story next when we look at the Holocaust, because the memory of Jewish participation in the Communist movement had tremendously disastrous results when World War II broke out. Thank you very much for watching.